awakened my senses in relation to the issues and the things that we've been talking about. A sense of strong community, for me, that has been very strong. It's global, but it's also very local, and technology has brought us even closer. There are many of us who want this change, and we don't need to feel alone. And that means that solidarity is absolutely essential. We really have to address the issue of solidarity and look at how it is that we enable, use solidarity to enable that transformation. And we have to be intentional about it. And we cannot achieve any of the things we want to do without dealing fundamentally with the trust issue. And being ready to live with some discomfort, take some risk to get us where we want to go. And it's very clear that the time is now. The momentum is here. So we should do everything that we can not to lose it. And I just want to share some of the brilliant stuff that we've all come up with. I'm sure when we see it, it will remind us, many of us, the different sessions that we've been in, some of them amazing things that came out of the sessions. So tech team, can you share with us some of the nuggets of wisdom that we've collected over these past 4 days? Thank you very much. These are some of the issues that have come up over the last 4 days. Can we move on to the next one? These are some of the key issues that have come up. The next slide, please. Yes. Change and what it requires. On funding, on leadership and governance, the inclusiveness, on solidarity, on accountability, all the different areas that we need to take care of. The next slide, please. Looking at transformational change in the sector. Making sure that the way we work is in sync with our values. Paying attention to how we are being, not only what we are doing. Mutuality, cooperation, and creativity. Intentionality, leadership, action. Can we go on to the next slide, please?
Nana, that is the last slide.
That is the last slide. Thank you very much. So these are the key things that have come up out from the different sessions. And it would be great to know what you have picked up from any of the sessions, just one thing that you've picked up. So can you please just pick up a piece of paper that's near you and write on that piece of paper something that resonated with you, something that you picked up in any of the sessions, something that for you struck some chord within you. Write it on a piece of paper boldly so that we can see it. I'll give us 2 minutes to put that down. And then on a count of three, raise it up to the camera, to your camera, and hold it for 10 seconds so that we can capture it. We want to take a screenshot of what it is that for you was meaningful. So for those few seconds, if you don't have your video on and you can put your video on, please put it on so that we can capture what was meaningful to you. So let me just give us the 2 minutes now, please. Just 2 minutes. Pick up a piece of paper and write down what for you was important. So I'm going to count three, and then you raise it up to your camera. One, tech team, I hope you are ready. We are going to capture. So let me count again. One, two, three. Can you raise up to your camera?
Nana, perhaps we can ask the people with blurred backgrounds to remove that for a second because their papers are not showing.
Okay, that may take some time. So I don't know if, okay, let's just give a couple of, maybe 1 minute for if you have a blurred background and you can just take that off for a minute and just so that we can see what you've written. Okay, I'm going to count again. One, two, three. Let's just show. Okay. Leslie, is that okay? Thank you very much.
That's perfect. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you very much. So the interesting thing is that, I mean, at this session, what we are going to be looking at is really, where do we go next? We are going to have a conversation on where we go next from this phase of RINGO. And to help us discuss this, there are three people who have extensive experience in this space, and they have a lot to share with us. So I'm going to introduce our speakers. I will begin with Deborah Doan, and then would go on to introduce Danny and Becky. And Deborah is the convener of the RINGO Project. Deborah has been steeped in civil society for about 25 years as a campaigner, as a leader, working across human rights, development, environment, and economic justice issues. And prior to RINGO, Deborah was the director of the Funders Initiative for Civil Society, which is a donor collaborative that works to create a more enabling environment for civil society. Some of her other roles have included the director of the World Development Movement, founder and director of the Corporate Responsibility Coalition in the UK, and they have achieved groundbreaking changes to UK company law to embed social and environmental accountability. She's the chair of Finance Uncovered and is a trustee of the Sheila McKenzie Foundation. She's also blogged regularly for The Guardian on international civil society issues, and she hosts the podcast, The Anti-Apathy Aunt. So that's Deborah Doan. And then I have Danny. Danny, I'm going to attempt to pronounce your full name. So Dr. Dananan Jayan Sriskandaranja. Danny, as we all know him. Has been a chief executive officer of Oxfam Great Britain since January 2019. And prior to that, he spent 6 years as Secretary General of Civicus, which is the Global Civil Society Alliance many of us know. He has previously been Director General of the Royal Commonwealth Society, Interim Director of the Commonwealth Foundation, and he's held various posts at the Institute for Public Policy Research. From 2018 to 2019, he was a member of the UN Secretary General's High-Level Panel on Digital Cooperation, co-chaired by Jack Ma and Melinda Gates, and from 2015 to 2016, a member of the High-Level Panel on Humanitarian Finance, and he's a trustee of the Disasters Emergency Committee. And the third speaker is Becky Konsi Moyo. Professor Becky Konsi Moyo is the director and adjunct professor of the Center of African Philanthropy and Social Investment, CAPSI, at the Wits Business School, Wits University. He's a writer, a researcher, a thought leader who has championed the African discourse on philanthropy, contributed to the growth of many African civil society formations, and has taken part in most of the continental processes of development and governance. He's gained considerable experience in management, leadership, and strategic roles over a significant period. He served as director of programs for the Pan-African organization Trust Africa, where he developed its strategy to cultivate a conducive investment and business environment. He was also the chief executive officer of the Southern Africa Trust, and he was also part of the formation of the African Union Foundation and became one of its founding council members. working closely with the AU chairperson. So I think you agree with me that we've got the right people to discuss this. Welcome to all three of you. Let me start first by asking Deborah to paint the contextual picture for us. So Deborah, what does this festival tell us about the future of the INGO? And you have about 8 to 10 minutes to address.
Great. Thank you so much, Nana. If you can indulge me for a moment, I'm going to share some slides, but they've all got pretty pictures on them. So you don't have to look at too many words. Let me do this. Minimize myself. Slideshow. Here we go. Oops. That's the first slide. Oh, I didn't have it right in the right order. You're seeing them all. Damn. Okay. So I'm here to talk about RINGO and the future of the INGO. And I'm so glad to be here. This has been quite a long and extraordinary journey. Danny will know, it all started, as will Nana, in a remote valley in South Africa about 5 years ago at Rustlers. I think it was 5 years ago. I've lost all track of time. So Danny was there, Nana was there, Jenny Richmond was there, Jenny Hodgson, Theo Sowa, Dagan Ali, and probably a few others who are all here right now. Everybody whinged about INGOs, everybody, myself included. So after, I think, some years of mulling, we came up with the RINGO project. And RINGO was specifically about change in INGOs, not necessarily about all of the other parts of civil society. We had intended to put some boundaries around it, even though in systems change, that's very difficult. So the project didn't necessarily go in that direction, but it took many directions, I want to go back to this original premise. When we set up RINGO, there was a demand from a lot of our stakeholders, including quite a lot of lab members, to try to articulate a vision for the INGO. And we purposefully avoided that. And we had to avoid it again and again and again. And not least because it can take years to do the right vision, but also once you get that vision, it may not be the right vision. Most importantly, we really wanted to focus on doing, on trying things out. And what I can say though, is that in the doing, there is a lot that our prototypes, even in this unrefined, incomplete stage, tell us about the future INGO model, its role, and in some cases, its lack of role. You've already seen all my slides. Let's go here. Do we even need INGOs? And I'll bet some of you are saying no. We heard a lot in the last few days about adapt, dying well, or dying badly. I think this is attributed to Barney Talek and Tosca de Bruna. Correct me if I'm wrong there. This is real. What was very interesting is that most of our prototypes were about bypassing INGOs altogether. And for many, it was almost as if they were trying to find a value add rather than there being an obvious fit. And this was very telling. Where there was a role, we found where we wanted some input and advice and collaboration with INGOs, many didn't have the capacity, they didn't have the time, they didn't have the skills or the networks to connect us. There was almost so much capacity building that needed to be done in the sector just to work differently on something as emergent as RINGO, to be able to be agile and to collaborate. So what we really learned here was that any reinvention of the INGO has to be done collaboratively. It can't be done with a board and the senior leadership team or even just the staff in a room. It needs to be done in co-creation mode across the civil society ecosystem. The very original study that Waxy did said that they want INGOs, but they want them to work differently. They want them to be in the room and co-creating. So I've been gathering my own thoughts and I tried to put together some initial broad brushstrokes about what our prototypes tell us about the purpose, role, and shape of INGOs. So, you know, a renewed purpose, see you later, gatekeeper. We don't need gatekeepers anymore. There is a high demand for direct relationships with supporters, with funders, with policymakers. And, you know, we saw this in many of our prototypes. You know, what became obvious was the need for facilitators, for connectors, for co-creators. But when we're stuck in those systems as I mentioned before, people don't even have the time to do that. I really think that new role function was demonstrated very well with our PGM prototype, that, you know, where we were seeking to for an INGO to connect resources to people in the grassroots, but not necessarily deciding what to do with it, unless there was a need for certain types of skills that the INGO had. I think we had a real missed opportunity in Ukraine to reinvent INGOs. It felt like, and I think this is backed by evidence, INGOs immediately reverted to fundraising, proving that they've got connections on the ground where they did not. There could have been so many other things they could have done with this new model. They could have connected, you know, developed, put some of the Disasters Emergency Committee funding, Danny, into an app to connect local groups with the well-meaning intentions of Westerners who just wanted to give to that crisis. Lots that could have been done here. I think we need to, we will be rebuilding the foundations. And sorry, Danny, I keep highlighting Oxfam here. Here's your office. Goodbye. Goodbye, top-down structures. Goodbye, large northern offices. Hello, networks. Technology and a demand for shared decision-making will lead to leaner structures, bottom-up, networked, federated, and probably virtual. Someone mentioned this yesterday. Fixed offices should be a thing of the past. This would bring a lot more money that could go to local civil society, but also to enable people to be everywhere. And I think there's a really important point here about the role of networks. There's a lot more that could be done through networks, through collaborative bodies, and a lot less through brand competition. One further point I want to make about structure and governance was really identified in our solidarity thinking. There was a lot around solidarity. The alternative solidarity model prototype in particular showed that grassroots communities can easily define what their needs are. But what they want to do is call out for those needs and see if INGOs can respond, not define those needs, not mediate those needs. So in a networked and bottom-up model, how we respond looks completely different. What does the future INGO and what did Ringo tell us about accountability and risk or trust? Goodbye, everybody hates log frames. I think you'll be grateful to say goodbye to those. The first time I met a log frame about 25 years ago, we fell out terribly. Goodbye, upwards reporting, risk-based accountability, mediated through some sort of English-speaking, Oxford-educated grad student. Hello, our prototypes talked a lot about negotiated accountability, about co-designed and agile systems, about accountability based on storytelling. They also talked about circular feedback and trust-based work that was locally led. And this is really important. By the risk prototype, gathered the whole value supply chain and was looking at negotiating what's proportionate and reasonable. And that's everyone from the bilateral donor, including the compliance and finance officer to the finance staff and INGOs all the way through. What's negotiate, what's important, what can be done through storytelling. I do want to do a great nod to the loop here that's really innovating in upwards feedback. Are INGOs prepared to be vulnerable? Jenny Hodgson yesterday, summed it up well. You need to get comfortable with being uncomfortable. And that's still a battle that we face, something I've been working on for the better part of 25 years when I started in the sector. And finally, on the staffing and the skills of INGOs, and this is the nitty gritty. This is some of the organizational stuff. By the way, I've stolen all of these photos, so don't, take them again. I downloaded them from the good old Google. Goodbye, Northern experts coming to save the poor. Obviously, we've been talking about this for many, many years now, but it still doesn't seem to change quickly enough. The real skills that are needed should be locally defined or defined by the needs of a collaborative network. And I think we need to think about new economy skills here. Skills that we noticed are lacking in the sector and are needed. AI skills. Our language team was desperate for them, couldn't find them anywhere. convening, networking, advocacy, the untying aid prototype is a clear point. This was a value add for Northern actors to put to play. But these skills can also be located anywhere. You know, RINGO is really developing that. We've got a global team working together. Those skills come from everywhere. And many are already moving in this direction, but we really need to see that take shape much more. I think we'll probably be going back to our roots, people-led, volunteer-based, community-based. The professional class will absolutely shrink. Bring in the solidarity class. RINGO didn't finish. We're not done yet. Mind the gap. For those of you who've been to London, that will be a familiar sound. We need to do a lot more on the internal work. We've only just started feminism and patriarchal leadership, for example, anti-racism models. Think around our governance. I don't think we've innovated enough around the structure of boards. We need to think about the charity model of governance versus cooperative governance structures. Maybe there is a new governance model that we could be adopting in the INGO sector that's more fit for purpose. Our business and financing models, you know, why is it when we have humanitarian agencies getting 90% of their humanitarian funding from governments? Why aren't they social enterprises? Do they need to be INGOs? What are they really? And so we need to be doing a lot more work to explore what those alternative business models and funding models really are. And of course, policy, much needs to change. We've only really started to scratch the surface. There is already a lot that's being done and a lot that's been identified. RINGO is just one platform, but it's a very rich platform. In the previous session, there was a poll that indicated many people feel their organizations are ready to change. And I do genuinely believe that many are. I felt the vibes this week. I felt the energy. But for those that are ready, just get on with it and try things out. Don't wait till you have all of your I's dotted and your T's crossed. And they also really reminded of that in the last session. And we do hope that RINGO has given you a really good idea of some places to start and a platform in which you can collaborate with some kindred spirits. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Deborah. Thank you very much. We are just some way on the journey. There's still a lot ahead that we need to deal with. We haven't finished. Saying bye-bye to gatekeepers, looking at direct connections, more collaborations, solidarity, networking, joint mutual accountability, less risk aversion, more risk awareness, and looking at bearing the risk together, trust-based relationships, looking at contextualized capacity and skills. And I like what you said about people-led, volunteer-based, community-based. I mean, those are things that I think that we would really need to look at. Alternative business models, should we need to be considering those as well? And the fact that we have these prototypes, we need to go ahead. We need to, if there's something, we have the idea, let's act, let's move, let's do, and stop too much of the talking. Fantastic. Thank you very much for setting this context for us. And I think it's a brilliant time to bring in Danny. Danny, you have really been working in this space for many years. You've been pushing this agenda. And it will be interesting to hear from you. What do you see as the opportunity now? And how is that different to what you saw before?
Thanks, Nana. Thanks, Deborah. And hi, everyone. Let me just also add, there's lots of people saying in the comments box about how wonderful the sort of RINGO process has been. And I've been a sort of bystander on the margins, and it's been wonderful to see the energy that you've built over these last few years through RINGO. But so Nana, you said I've been at this for many years, and in some ways I haven't, right? So I'm currently, and have been since January 2019, the chief exec of Oxfam Great Britain, which is an important part of a big INGO. But this is my first job in an INGO. In fact, this is my first job in an organization that's bigger than about 100 people. And so for me, the last 3.5 years has been also about learning about what what life is like inside one of these operations. And I do remember very, very well, Deborah, the conversations we had in Rustlers Valley 5 years ago. And I was one of those people complaining about INGOs. You know, when I was at Civicus and looking around the world and civil society under greater threat than ever before, looking around the world and watching as almost all of the actors that I cared for and respected in civil society were struggling to get resources, so were struggling to get sort of core resources, it was frustrating to see some actors in civil society have these very large and stable flows of income that help them, you know, be resilient and protect themselves against all sorts of shocks. And the INGOs were some of those actors that I thought were sort of hoarding, if you will, resources and power at a time when it was. You know, in these 3.5 years at Oxfam, it's been fascinating and in some ways fulfilling to be part of a journey. It's not complete by any means, to try to reimagine, as you say. And, you know, I think one way of putting it is, I think there are many of us who, you know, there's probably a dingo project out there somewhere. It's not called that, but that's to sort of dismantle the international NGO group, right? Which, you know, there are lots of people who say, yes, there isn't a future for INGOs. Why do we have these sort of archaic 20th century formations based, as you say, Deborah, on a notion of charity and bureaucracy and structure? Shouldn't we just have much more agile and interesting formations in civil society? And then, although they don't describe themselves as that, there's probably the sort of gringo lobby, which is the GROW international NGO sort of group. And, you know, people don't know that they're part of it, that there are many people who've been inside NGOs who've been sort of obsessed with growth. They're saying success comes from getting to the next billion euro of turnover or whatever it is. And I used to, when I was at Civicus, one of my favorite things to do was open the annual report of any INGO and try to find what page the word growth would appear. And it's almost always in the first few pages. You know, our ambition is to grow. I saw an annual report of a UK-based INGO chapter the other day who had four strategic goals. One of them was maximize income. And so you've got, you know, the sort of dingo and the gringo extremes on either side. But I think the idea of reimagining INGOs is important. And I have several observations that maybe hint at why things are a bit different at the moment. One is, so Oxfam Great Britain turned 80 last month. We were founded in October 1942. And what's fascinating is we have evolved and transformed many times over in that 80 years, right? We were founded by volunteers. We didn't have a single paid staff member for at least a decade. It was entirely a volunteer-run organization. We didn't have a southern office for 20 years or so, because all we did was collect resources in the global north and transfer them to partners in other parts of the world. And we predated what we call the aid system, right? Aid wasn't even invented for the first 20 odd years of, you know, formal official overseas development aid. And then you can see, you know, over the last 30, 40 years, the organization transforming into what we now call an international NGO, moving large amounts of resource, playing in the sort of aid ecosystem. And in many ways, the concerns that many of us have are about how to modernize or reimagine this set of structures. But what's been really fascinating for me is that what we take for granted now is only a few decades old. Because if you looked at Oxfam in 1950 or 1960, it would have resembled a sort of solidarity-based informal network, much smaller, or with absolutely no government income, because government aid budgets weren't there at that time. You know, it was entirely privately funded by donations or social enterprise income, as you say, Deborah, because we started running secondhand shops in the UK as early as 1947, 48. So I suppose one observation, what's different is we say, it might be difficult to reimagine. It shouldn't be difficult, because in most of these organizations, you just have to go back a few years or a few decades to see how different things once were. The second observation is I've been involved in the Pledge for Change conversation that some of you may be also aware of. And this is a personal reflection, is I do worry a little bit that we are, the INGO in some way was built to move money and knowledge down, right? So you collect money from the global north and you move it to the global south, or you have technical expertise and you move it to the global south. And the resistance has often been to do it the other way around. So it's, how do we build power up? How do we take power or shift power, depending on the way you want to see it? And I can see that dynamic, the sort of in the vertical spectrum, to try to reclaim power. But if our job is to build people's power going forward, is to build civic interventions or civic institutions, if you want that, to make this world radically better, to fight for justice and solidarity and sustainability, then we might want to think much more about the sort of horizontal, about the solidarity. I saw many people put solidarity up on their signs, right? Which is then less about sort of north-south moving power up or down, or moving money down or up, but building for a new world in which we really do share. We used to call it South-South collaboration, or solidarity-based institutions, whatever else it is. And I do wonder a little bit about whether sort of the sort of reimagining we have to do is around that. So those are just a couple of observations about, I think, where we are then, and my learning over the last few years here. Back to you, Nana. Thanks.
So much, Danny. I mean, the number of key things that you have raised. I think what struck me was the fact that the INGOs didn't start this way. This was not the model that they started with. It has evolved over the years into what we have now. So we could actually go back. There's something called Sankofa, go back and take it. You go back to take the things. If you've seen, those of you who've seen this symbol of a bird with its feet pointing forward and looking backwards, taking an egg from its back. It's called Sankofa, go back and take it. It means go back and take something that is precious and help, that would help you to move forward with it. And that is what I think the INGOs have to look at to do as we think of reimagining the INGOs. So that struck me. And the other thing for me was that we have to look at having a horizontal movement. We've been talking a lot about solidarity, about interdependence. And I think that really is it aligns with this idea of a horizontal movement. Thank you very much, Danny, for your thoughts. I will come back to you, but let me move to Becky. And you know that those who have power don't give power easily. They don't give it up easily. So for now, what do you see as the role of organizations and civic actors, civil society in the global south to demand change, to get this kind of horizontal movement that we need? And what do we need to change about ourselves? I mean, I am in the global south. I come from the global south, so that's why I'm identifying with this. What we need to change about ourselves in the global south in the way that we work? It's Becky.
Thank you so much, Nana, and let me first thank you and the Ringo team for what has been an interesting 3 days. I've been in and out, but I also want to thank Danny, because I've really followed his work when he was here with Civicas and now with Oxfam GB. I think I'm not sure I'm going to answer your question, but let me do something about it. So sticking with the theme of birds, I think the sky is big enough to accommodate all the birds. And as we know, birds migrate at various seasons and they never collide when they are doing so. Mm. And this is the vision that I think, you know, this project is about. It's about INGOs and those in the global south not colliding in this big sky. So I want to start there because I think it's very important for us to recognize that if we are to get proper outcomes out of this process, we have to understand and accept that everyone has a place and has a role, but it's about how we coordinate and understand the various nodes of coordination. So the past 3 days to me have been seeing these birds finding ways to avoid collision. So how do we do this going forward? Firstly, for me, I think it's important for those in the global south to think about what power actually means. What does it really mean? What is it about and what it is not? Where does power reside? In what form and what are its different expressions? For example, do people who have access to spaces, people who have the loudest voices, does it necessarily mean that they are powerful? At times it's not. We know how people have been silenced by being given voices. But even people with the biggest amounts of money, at times they are not the most powerful. They are actually disempowered through financing. So this analysis of understanding where power resides, who wields it, how power is wielded is important for me, especially for those in the global south. I think at times we get into discussions where we are demanding for power, but we have not done a proper analysis of what power looks like and where it should be, at what point in any given point in time. So before negotiating for this shifting of the power, let's understand what power do INGOs wield. And what power do those in the South actually wield? Because they do have power. So some power mapping exercise is important. And you know, so we need to understand our positionality as those institutions in the global South vis-a-vis the broader you know, quest that we are looking for. So if we, these past 3 days have been looking at INGOs and those in the global South, but we haven't done a proper political economy analysis of those INGOs and their governments, for example. We can have an agreement here about what INGOs need to do, but what about their governments? And their governments are actually an important component of how they end up being configured, either through funding mechanisms and otherwise. What about their donors? Because their donors also still have certain conditionalities and certain expressions and mechanisms that they would want INGOs to also follow. So there's a lot in the ecosystem, but also I think in the value chain that we need to analyze as people in the global south before you know, going to asking for shifting of the power. Who is leading this reimagination? Who is in and who is out? So we need to ask for the right things. That's what I'm saying, Nana. We need to ask for the right things. What exactly are we asking for when we talk about shifting power? As you heard from Theo and others, why would those with power want to shift it in the first place? Mm-hmm. Why did they have the power? How did they acquire it? It's important to answer these questions, because if we don't, we are going to be chasing shadows and mirrors, in my view. I'm always comfortable with practical, meaningful, and equitable outcomes. And so I will probably take the midway between what Danny described as dingoes and gringos. So in this regard, I suggest a staged process in reimagining this relationship. The first is restructuring power. I think for me, that's the first stage. Let's think about restructuring power. Where should various nodes of power reside, both in the South and in the North? What are the immediate changes that we all want to see? I think a lot of what was discussed in the last 3 days, including the prototypes, in my view, would fit here in the restructuring of power. And here, everyone is accommodated. Everyone is accommodated in one form or the other. We just need to figure out a mechanism and a formula for actually doing that. My next stage is sharing power. This is, for me, important because if we are to reimagine INGOs and their relations with those in the Global South, we need to talk about how power needs to be shared. Is it going to be shared equally? Is there going to be a formula that we are going to use based on competencies, context, demands, and all of that? But power needs to be shared in one form or the other. What we have not discussed is how that power should be shared. So that's my second stage. And I wanted to emphasize those two for me because we need to understand how we got here. How did we get here? And I think Jenny has tried to explain a bit of that. But for me, it's important to make this point that some INGOs have actually followed a colonial pattern. And why am I saying that? It's because if you look at how colonialism took place, it had certain patterns. One of them was secularist pattern. You come in and you actually become a secular in the colony. And that's what has happened with some of the INGOs. They've moved everything, both body, knowledge, systems into the South. And that's what we are calling today a localization agenda. But that's secularism. That's what colonizers did. They actually moved and settled in the Global South. If we don't understand that and talk about it as a form of a pattern that reminds us of the past, then we're not going to reimagine this. And if we're asking to shift power, we will never shift the power. Secondly, there was assimilation. Assimilation was another form or pattern of colonialism. And again, it's important to understand the different patterns in which some INGOs are actually assimilating those in the South. We have lots of us now who are assimilated into INGOs in person, in ideology, and otherwise. So when we talk about these processes, we need to understand that there's behavior, there's the white gaze, there's the language, there's the localization agenda. All these either fit in the secularist mode or in the assimilation mode. And they are still happening today, which is why I find it very difficult for me to talk about decolonizing philanthropy or decolonizing relations, because that ended. But what has not ended is the colonial patterns. And therefore, the decolonial thinking and decolonial interventions are what we should be looking at. And so it's important for us to know that the colonial vestiges are still around. How do we dismantle those colonial vestiges? And so for me, immediately going to shifting power does not address that, because you are already creating a situation where there's going to be defense mechanisms played into denialism. So let's get into a stage process, which is a long journey, and focus on decolonial interventions. Maybe Nana, at some day we'll get to shifting the power. But for me, shifting the power is not the end game, because we must ask the question, what will happen to those who would have shifted the power? What will happen to them? What will they do? We need to ask that question. The end game for me is in the big sky. And it is to talk to issues that were raised here around solidarity, around mutuality. And I think we can learn a lot from social movements here. There are a number of prototypes that were presented, but also a number of other mechanisms that have taken place in the Global South. Ekutu Ubumbano is one of them, where churches in the Global North have actually worked with those in the Global South to work out an exit mechanism that takes into account shifting of skills, of capacities to the South. If we have time, I would want to come back and talk about a future of engagement, which I wrote about in a report that I did called Barriers to Civil Society Engagement, where I look in depth into the issues relating to INGOs and local groups in the South. And among those will be issues to do with building sustainability for local organizations in the Global South, because that's one of the biggest issues. Donor dependency is what leads us to where we are. We need to reverse that. There are issues around accelerating digital transformation, and a lot of what was being discussed around, you know, pivoting to new ways of working is anchored on us talking about accelerating digital transformation. But there's a point about leadership and succession, which is also important. It's about the kind of leaders that we have that are able to either reimagine this relationship or lead the degrowth or lead the growth of INGOs. And then, of course, we need to enable the diverse voices. And so I end up with my analogy of the sky is big enough for all the birds to fly, but we just need to make sure that they are coordinated.
Thank you very much, Becky. Thank you very much. I think some of the key issues that you have raised, one of the things we should look at, we should do a power analysis and the power mapping. I think that there's some work that is being done and has been done on that, but it's important to bring it into the discussion. The issues around, I like the way you put it, where does power reside? Who wields it? Where should it be? And I think I'll also add, how should it be used? And the fact that INGOs themselves could sometimes be powerless because of their governments and their donors, who actually are the ones who hold the power. You have mentioned that we should look at a staged process, restructuring power, and then also look at how power is shared. And I like what you talked about. I mean, this one is the professor coming in, decoloniality and decolonization, and the differences between those two. And the fact that we need to really look at we can talk about post-colonial. You can say colonialism is gone. We no longer have colonialism, but we still have it because there are models that are colonial models that we have. You talked about the settler model, assimilation, and those are different things that INGOs, it's a pattern that INGOs have taken up as well. So we need to be addressing some of those things. But the point that you have made is that the sky is big enough. It's big enough for all of us, and we must find a way of working together and coordinating that work. So I think that is key, and we must really take it on. I will come back to you, but I just wanted to ask a few questions as we go ahead. And this really is about the sky being big and looking at those who are not in those beds that should be there that are not part of it, that we need to be bringing in. So who should be part of this process? Who are those that we should be looking at? How do we get them to join? Deborah, I will bring you in, but let me first hear Danny on this. Who else should be part of this process?
Wow. Well, so part of the challenge, and I was accused of it often at Civicus, or Civicus was often accused of being sort of like having a sort of organizational fetish or being NGO centric, right? And there is that sort of challenge, because you don't have to go back too far to have societies where the sort of even the very notion of an institutionalized nonprofit organization with a distinctive charity or not-for-profit registration. Right. These are all, in many cases, relatively new concepts. I mean, in the UK, where I'm calling in from, it's a relatively old concept. We've had for just over 400 years the notion of a registered charity. And that's been amazing in some ways, right? Because it's protected this notion that institutions in society are there to pursue the common good or the public good, and they have a certain set of privileges but also responsibilities. But at the moment, my worry is we've sort of fetishized this idea that the NGO is going to be at the vanguard of delivering social change. But everywhere we look, that assumption is being challenged. It's being challenged. You know, it's been years since I've met a young person, a young activist, who tells me that their dream is to work for an NGO, right? Like, whereas my generation, my dream literally was to work in NGOs, because I thought that's where, you know, social change happens. But there are young people who are questioning this sort of model. There are companies that are acting more like a progressive NGO than some NGOs, right? They're just sort of, they're social enterprises, or they're taking their climate commitments far more seriously than many of us do, and so on. And so in that context, for me, I think to directly answer your question, Nana, it's to be really aware of, to use Becky's language, the sky and how big really it is, right? And to stop even seeing the world through the sort of formalized NGO type lens, because we've not only sort of settled and colonized, but we've replicated through the sort of mini-me structure right, in many parts of the world. That's been the sort of expansion model for the, or the logic that's driven. And it's not just the international NGOs. Even, I know lots of national NGOs who could also be accused of being motivated by that logic. So I think it's involving as many actors as possible, but from this assumption that our model, or the model that we've assumed to be at the vanguard of delivering social change, is probably no longer fit for purpose, or is probably no longer, or in 20 or 30 years time, is not going to be at the vanguard of what we want to do. So it's going there with that sort of genuinely open approach to testing new formations and new ways of organizing and mobilizing.
Great, thank you. Becky, what about you? Who have we left out?
Yeah, so I'm not so sure whether I should be answering who is left out, but at least who do I think ought to be part of the process? So for me, looking at the context currently in the continent and in the global south, I think the private sector is definitely one of the institutions that must be engaged. Because at the end of the day, we are all working towards solving social problems for the common good. And so what is the role of the private sector in our different countries and contexts in solving those challenges that are facing us, inequality, issues of climate change, among others? So we can't really be thinking about solving the problems of the world without including the private sector in its various formations. Of course, the private sector's business is business, and we know that there have been calls and campaigns around making sure that the private sector is also a corporate citizen. So I think it would be important in this journey to figure out ways in which we can look at the private sector and what it can do, either in financing and making sure that local actors are sustained, but also doing its part in solving the challenges of the global south. And that will in many ways help make sense of whether we need a big intervention from INGOs, or we need them reimagined in different ways. The second is, I think we also need to talk about the UN system as well as our governments. That's an important component, because those of you who have been following, especially in the philanthropic space, the UN system is also getting very much involved in that space and in solving those issues. And so we cannot ignore the UN system. We cannot ignore the government. Like I said, in the political economy analysis, we need to think about what government's role is and how it influences geopolitical considerations. But I also think that for us here in Africa, for example, African philanthropy is an important component. We saw during the COVID period what happened. Our high net worth individuals gave seven times more than they've done in the past 10 years. So that means the resources to sustain local interventions are here. It's just a question of preferences, which is the same thing as other donors. There are certain preferences that they want to support. But if we are to work with them and really drill this message around the role that civil society plays in its various formats, and the role that philanthropy can play, especially African philanthropy, we'll be getting to finding some mechanisms and solutions around that. But I also think that in this conversation, we need to look at the various layers of civil society. So as you are speaking right now, there's just one type of civil society that is involved in this conversation. Adam Abib and Rupert Taylor did a fantastic paper many years ago looking at the various layers. So you can start at the grassroots layer level. Who is involved there, and what is their relationship with the INGOs world? What is their relationship with government? More often, they are just survivalists, right? And so how do we make sure that their voices are also part of this process? Because at the end of the day, if they are not part of this process, why are we here? We are here because we are saying we want to, do services for them, but they are not in this conversation. So we need to get social movements, we need to get grassroots organizations involved in one form or the other. But we also have advocacy groups that may not take the form of an NGO, but can take the form of social movements, for example. And those come and go depending on the issues at any given point in time. So how do we bring those as well? And they've developed a whole experience around issues of solidarity And as Dan was talking about South-South solidarity, you find that mainly in social movements. So what kind of lessons can we draw from there? So I would see us really, you know, doing that layering of the different types of civil society, because NGOs are just one form of civil society, but there are other forms of civil society that are equally important, and the answer might actually lie there than in the NGO model.
Great. Thank you very much, Becky. Deborah, your thoughts?
Yeah, I want to riff off a few of these things. I do want to say, ask anyone you know who doesn't work in civil society what civil society is, and they have no idea, right? This is a mission I'm on personally. You know what the private sector is, you know the many forms of the private sector, but you don't know about civil society. And ideally, we wouldn't be starting with the institutions, right? We'd be starting with climate change, inequality, poverty, choose your issue, disaster, conflict. And then what is the formal and the informal people-based organization, civil society system that will help to contribute to solve those problems? But the reality is the institutions of INGO still take up a lot of space, right? They probably need to fulfill a better potential and take up less space in the civil society ecosystem, which is why with RINGO, we keep coming back to, okay, but what do we do about INGOs? Should they all just collapse and then we design around an issue? Maybe that is the answer. I want to refer to it, you know, Dr. Moyo said, is we all have agency. What do you do with the people who shifted power? So if INGOs collapse, and I see a lot of this in my peers and my friends, myself sometimes, I want to go and bake and make cheese, as my RINGO colleagues know. They just say, I'm done. I'm out, right? I'm finished. But, you know, we're all part of that place in making change. So we have to think of ourselves as change agents and actors in the system. And even if it's not through INGOs and we shift power, we still have to be part of civil society. And we have to empower people to think of the different ways that they can become engaged in solidarity in civil society. Now, that brings full circle back to where you started, Nana, which is who needs to be part of this conversation? Everyone. We're all part of civil society, but we do need those actors that give too much dominance and voice to the INGO. And the Ukraine example, I'll come back to it again, is a really good case in point. There's still a lot of oxygen, a lot of resources going to that, even if, as Dr. Moyo says, they don't have as much power as they think they have. Those are my two cents.
Those are interesting points, but let me say that it's easier said than done. When we say everyone, I mean, we've talked about the private sector, the UN system, the, you know, African philanthropists, the various layers of civil society. What do you perceive? And Becky, I'll be starting from you this time round. You can just give me about two of these. What do you perceive to be the possible challenges that we are going to face, or we would be facing, you know, in this journey that we are on to reimagine the INGO and address the issues of shifting power? Two key challenges for you.
Yeah, I think I've kind of alluded to one, which is that I think there needs to be genuine understanding of what we are embarking on in terms of what we are asking for in the Global South and what those in the Global North are supposed to be shifting. Because if we don't really understand, or we get into it without genuineness, then all we are going to do is we will be getting into a train that has already left the station and it won't change anything. So that's the first for me, a clear trust-based understanding of where we are going, and clarifying the different, you know, both positives and negatives that are likely to happen on the way, and figuring out how you're going to mitigate it, because it's a journey, and as any journey, it's not straightforward. It's bound to have pitfalls and so forth and so on. So I think that's, for me, the most important thing. I always find that these conversations at times are not that genuine. We say the right things, but we don't do the right things. So that would be the first challenge for me. Are we able to do the right things as we are saying them today, because it's easy for executives to come and say, we are going to do this, we're going to do that. But when they go back, their boards and their governments and other things just put limits to them, and there's nothing that they can do. So let's be practical about what we can do. Let's also figure out stages in which we can do it. In regional integration, you talk about, you know, certain ways in which countries that are ready can do so, and those that are not ready can join later, right? So variable geometry is one of the principles in regional integration. Why don't we think about such stages also, about those that are ready and they are able to shift this power or share it, let's let them do so. And then by so doing, they're going to influence others. And over time, we will see the change that we are looking for. I think the rush to overhaul the system is a great idea, but in practical terms, it doesn't work, in my view. So that's the first. The second, I think, is going to be the shifting nature of challenges that are facing the world. Because at the end of the day, as Deborah was saying, we should ideally be starting at what are the key issues that are leading us to configure ourselves this way, right? It's possible that at some point, you actually will need a multitude of INGOs because of their infrastructure, because of their access to resources, to actually solve a problem in the global south. Because the vehicle must be fit for purpose. And there will be moments when actually the vehicle is too big for purpose. So how do we also do that? So for me, the fluidity in terms of the changing issues that are facing the world are also going to determine whether or not you are going to have the dominance of certain types of civil society or not. And so understanding that fluidity is important for us. I think the other stuff really can really be discussed and sorted, but for me, those two will be the main things to think about.
Thank you. Challenges. Danny.
Two challenges. One is trying to articulate confidently and clearly what the role of the northern bits of these networks are. Right? I work for the GB bit, the Great Britain bit of Oxfam, and part of our journey over the last few years has been to be really clear about what our role is that we do uniquely or distinctly from the rest of the organization and the rest of civil society. And that's been really important for us because it has then, we've been very clear about, collecting resources in the UK or in Great Britain, which is one of the things that we can do, but be also nuanced about that and say, that might be around collecting individual resources, running our social enterprise, but not getting in the way of others accessing institutional donors, for example. So that sort of having a clear and confident view, because I often find that many folk in the sort of development sector in countries like the UK are feeling like they don't know what their role is these days, amidst talk of decolonization and localization. Whereas if we are to build that solidarity horizontally, that everyone has to play a role, right? We want everyone to be part of these amazing civic institutions or creations, but be clear about where their role and sort of where the limits of their role should be, so that they're not trying to colonize or do more than that. And so I think that's one challenge has been, it can be done, but it's been a really difficult and sometimes uncomfortable conversation because it has meant, for example, very difficult choices about what roles sit in the UK or in the British bit of Oxfam. And we've had to make some very difficult choices in the last few years and reduce the number of roles that sit here vis-a-vis the rest of, not just Oxfam, but the rest of civil society. So that so that's been one. And the other is, I talked a bit about the R in the Ringo and then about the sort of NGO bit and saying we shouldn't just focus on the NGO. But maybe another challenge is the I, the international. And it's a challenge because, I suspect all of us on this call, and I don't know how many countries or parts of the world we're dialing in from, but in one way, what's unique about our community and what we're trying to do is we're trying to reimagine a sort of new internationalism, because we are committed to this idea that, we have to build power locally, But that's not sufficient, right? Especially given all those challenges we're facing that are, you know, climate change or inequality or vaccine access. They're all fundamentally global challenges. And so we need global connective tissue in civil society as well that allows us to amplify or build beyond borders. But why I say it's a challenge is because almost all of the other models of internationalism that we have out there feel broken, right? I mean, the obvious one, which Becky has talked about, is colonialism, right? The sort of audacity of the colonial project was it just sort of thrust its version of internationalism onto the world. But same with, you know, the corporate, you know, the global capitalism has its version of internationalism, which has involved extraction, agglomeration, transnational corporations. And, you know, there's been a bit of conversation about the United Nations. You can say even that model of the sort of mid-20th century notion of how international or intergovernmental relations should work also feels tired. It entrenches power of certain states. It has a sort of democratic deficit or a double democratic deficit around citizen participation. So wherever you look, whether it's sort of colonial notions of internationalism, capitalist notion of internationalism, or tired intergovernmental notions of internationalism, our models don't, the models that could inspire us don't look like they're fit for purpose. So it's a challenge because I think we have to sort of lead by example in a sort of bold new internationalism that allows us to, you know, not just build from below, but beyond borders and connect and people and power across borders. And that's going to, it's really difficult to do without being, you know, neo-colonial or being monolingual or being, you know, privileging those with digital access, all those pitfalls that we know are real, but we have to do it because the other models of internationalism are doing the world a disservice at the moment.
Thank you. Thank you for that. Deborah, the challenges.
Very quickly, three challenges, letting go of our egos. Like, we don't need to go into detail. We've been talking about that all week, but it's very difficult. And I think linked to that is the power of boards and the governance structures, which I hear time and time again are a barrier to change. And I think it's a challenge. How do we wrest control of our institutions from those entities? I'm very practical, as you can see. And finally, another practical challenge, process. Not building in time within our day-to-day working lives, within our institutions to allow for the processes to make the change happen, to create those spaces. Everyone in our prototypes expressed this as a challenge and a problem. And in the session earlier today, I want to highlight this. I think it was 40 or 50% of people said they were experiencing burnout. This wasn't just Global North, this was Global North, Global South, at every level. We're spinning wheels trying to get stuff done. So a challenge in making any shift in the way that we act and finding our new models of solidarity, letting go of old spaces, I think we've got to make the processes and the time to do so. Very practical, but really hard to do.
Yeah, but important to be aware of. I think you've all raised very critical issues that I think we need to be aware of. And very often we are the last people to take care of ourselves, coming to the points that you are making. And if we want to, one of the ways of doing that is taking off some of the burden, sharing the burden and supporting, and also, you know, supporting each other. And I think you've raised some very key issues, and I don't want to reiterate all the things that you have said. But just one last point, and then I want to combine that with a call for action, because there's the momentum now. I mean, clearly the discussion is all over. Bilaterals are having it, INGOs are having it, NGOs, all over. We are getting this discussion on reimagining the INGO, shifting power, localization. Of course, you can talk about the way it's been defined in different ways, but there is that discussion on the table. How do we sustain the momentum to ensure that we don't lose, you know, this momentum for transformation to happen? And you, as you talk, I mean, when you talk about that, I would also like you to include a call for action so that we go away with some practical things that we need to do. And I would also invite the audience, colleagues on online, to put in the chat your own call for action in looking at how we sustain this momentum that we have so that we don't lose it. What would you tell funders? What would you tell INGOs? What would you tell organizations working in the Global South as well? What is your call for action? How do we do this to sustain the momentum? So please let me start first with Danny.
So that's a great question. I've got lots of potential answers. Let me stick to a few. One is around accountability, right? Enough, as several people have said, enough talk, enough promises, enough pledges. We need to be calling out bad practice, but also celebrating good practice. And I think that's going to be really important because you can't just assume these things will happen, as you say. I think a call to action around sort of the art of unrestricting resource. I think one of the things that I found the deeper I'm into an INGO system is we've become really good or really bad, depending on your view, at making resources conditional, right? You know, there's a series of transactions that happen in the sort of international development ecosystem. And with each transaction, there seems to be new and more conditions that have been introduced, right? Whereas I think we need to say, how can I, especially about money, and it's not only about money, but do this in as sort of empowering and unrestricted a way as possible. And our experience at Oxfam GB is that that's actually really, it seems difficult, but it's easier than you think. And it's really fun and liberating when you do it well. So, we've just recently we've changed our internal allocation processes so that discretionary funding, as it used to be called, from the northern bits of Oxfam to southern bits of Oxfam, are genuinely unrestricted, so that it's not someone sitting in Oxford who's saying, oh, you know, we're really interested in program X or program Y, and we'd like you to do project Z about this and report back to us at the end of 12 months. We say, well, you know, we've got there's mutual accountability here. We've got a common set of systems, a common code of conduct. We've got reporting mechanisms if something goes wrong. So here's the resource unrestricted. And then the third is, coming back to the sort of the role of the Northern NGO is, you know, especially maybe I'm being sentimental because we've been marking our 80th birthday, but there is something wonderful and special about, you know, in our case, 8 ordinary British people coming together in 1942 because they wanted to challenge government and raise money and build international solidarity, and they were compassionate about people who lived far from Britain. That's wonderful. We need to get our confidence back, but do it in a very new way, because do this idea that, you know, we are an instrumental part of that sort of that new internationalism as well, because, you know, we want to, you know, if you take the shops, as I said, we have 600 shops in the UK that sell, you know, that collect donated items and sell secondhand clothing and other things. We're part of the sort of sustainable consumption revolution. We want to be ambitious about that because we want to change behaviors in the UK. But really importantly, we're raising unrestricted resource, right? In our case, about £20 million a year, give or take, comes from that social enterprise. And the job is to, you know, be ambitious about that bit, because we're really uniquely placed to grow that source of resourcing for us and others in, you know, our allies and partners. And we want to be sort of clear and confident about that value add, but be really careful about not encroaching on the spaces and freedoms of others who we want to accompany or claim to be serving. Thanks.
Thank you, Danny. Becky, call for action.
Thanks, Nana. I think maybe to start on around the point of, you know, there was a question around civic space and how it is affected by this. So my sense is that one of the issues we need to look at in terms of thinking about a call for action is the expansion of the civic space into now incorporating the cyberspace. And I think what Danny was talking about, the new model of internationalism might actually be configured also by utilizing the new spaces that have been opened up by digital spaces. There's no geography there. We are all in this space right now, but dialing in from different regions and different geographies. So how do we take advantage of the new digital spaces and learning, for example, from other organizations and lessons, for example, women in North Africa, for example, who have actually utilized the digital space to challenge some of the closing mechanisms by the patriarchal state, whether it's through use of narrow casting and other new initiatives. But it's important for us to think about the expanded civic space that is no longer about the geographic location, important as it is, but there's now another form, and what can we build out of that? So that's the first, maybe, you know, kind of building the technological infrastructure and the digital infrastructure for organizations, especially in the Global South, is important. And here, I think the private sector plays a huge role in terms of providing the resources that would be required to build that infrastructure. But secondly, there's the role of the NGOs, because we cannot do away with NGOs in one form or the other, especially around capacity empowerment, skills transfer, among others. So there is that need in terms of this call for action in building the technological and digital infrastructure for organizations. But I also think that has to be accompanied by some sort of movement building processes. I think something like this requires a movement. I think movements are known for making these transformative changes. And here, I think we need to build the confidence of the leaders and the groups in the South. And so there are a number of institutions that are already doing something like that. And I think, you know, going forward, we need to build this movement and connect with the various initiatives, like you were saying, Nana, that are already in one form or the other addressing this particular issue. So for me, it would be the digital transformation as well as movement building. And there are certain initiatives there that we can look at.
Thank you very much. I want to share some of the calls for action in the from the chat that we have. Where Majid, I hope I'm pronouncing your name well, Van Wessel, says, what I think we need is evidence that change works better southern-led in southern contexts, that evidence needs to be produced and showcased to convince and legitimize audiences that are not convinced yet. If southern-led needs to become the right way forward, this seems to be a condition for at least some of the actors involved. And Tim Boyce Watson says, now Danny is speaking my accounting language. Progressive donors are unrestricting funding, but why on earth are nonprofits restricting internally? In fact, the very reason to have a nonprofit or charity as a legal form is so that people can give to it with a certainty that their gift will be used for the cause without needing to restrict their donation. And Mamata Dash says, build collective agency to disrupt power. So these are some of the things that have come. Mustafa has posted something in the chat, I think, that we can click and also look at. So these are some of the calls for action that have also come from the colleagues online. Thank you very much for a very insightful discussion. I think that there's so much food for thought, and so many things have come out, you know, over these 3 days, this fourth day, that I think makes us realize that there's still so much to do. We've done a lot, but there's still so much to do. And the points that you are making, Becky, about building a movement, and the point you're making, Danny, about looking at this new internationalism and really thinking it through and working together to enable this to happen. And some of the things you said, Deborah, about letting go of our ego. So we also have that internal work that has to be done. All these things come together to enable the birds in the sky find their space. And I want to thank the three of you so much for your very instructive insights. So where do we go from here? What are the next steps? And I want to just give you an idea of where RINGO is going, what the future holds for RINGO. A number of things are going to happen, or we've planned would happen. One, WACSI will take up the reins of the hosting role, and building on the fantastic foundations that the Right School Lab has laid. Many of the prototypes that you've been introduced to and that you have discussions on will continue to meet and work. And we will ensure that those that need to keep working will have hosts and coordination support. So many of you would be engaged. Some of the organizations here are going to be contacted. There are some that already have hosts. Those that do not have hosts, but that you are interested in hosting, I think we need to have a discussion on this as well. Influencing, we've been saying that this is ecosystem work. This is ecosystem transformation. So we need to influence the whole sector. And funders, which the sector includes funders, to address the gaps. So in the first quarter of 2023, WACSI, RIOS, and the RINGO core team, we will be planning where we need to go as a community to anchor that commitment and change. And we want to keep this community together. We want to grow it. It's a movement, you know, that we really want to make sure we sustain. Then we would also look at how do we develop tools that the sector can use. And we will be speaking to funders, and we'll definitely welcome others who want to have that conversation with us. So as I've been speaking, I'm sure there are some or many of us who are wondering, how do I stay connected to this community? How do I become a part of this movement? So if you want to stay in touch with us, Leslie, I would ask that you post a link for that in the chat so that anybody who is interested can connect with RINGO through that link. And now something that is very important. RINGO will not have come this far without the immense contribution, technical contribution, financial, time, material, so many other resources that several individuals and institutions have put into it. People trusted and took a risk on RINGO because they were tired of talking and wanted to act and change their status quo. Imagine something different, dynamic, transformative for the INGO and for the whole civil society and development ecosystem. So they supported in so many ways. And for us, this is the time to say thank you. In my culture, when somebody says, does something for you, you don't only say thank you individually, you actually go with others also to say thank you. So please join me and my colleagues to thank the following people and institutions that we will be seeing on our screens. And this is the way you can help me do that. Type into the chat box, thank you in your language, traditional or official language, and you can put into brackets the language and country or the group. So I can say, for example, Midase. Midase is tree. It's a tree, it's the language in Ghana, or Shukuran in Arabic, or Asante in Swahili. So can we go? Let's just say thank you. Type in your language, thank you in your language. Let's thank these people who are coming onto our screens. To our funders, these are the people who have funded us. So thank you to our funders. Can we see thank you to the next slide, please? The next group. There are institutional partners. These are the institutional partners who have supported RINGO over the years. Thank you very much. Thank you very much. To the next, can we see the next slide? And these are the organizations that are already hosting some of the prototypes that we have introduced you to this week. And we want to say thank you to them. Merci beaucoup. Obrigado, obrigada. Let me say thank you to our advisory board. And I want to mention their names here. Deborah Willick, Degana Lee, Enrique Pirases, Eva Joyce Wynn, Francisco Lara, Irungu Houghton, Jonathan Glennin, Lydia Alpiza, Lisa John, Theosowa, and Wolfgang Jaman. They have all supported with their advice on to Ringo on how we need to, we should proceed on this journey. Thank you very much. And then I cannot mention all these names, but these are the people who actually did the work, actually going through the inquiry process, making sense of what it was that they found, coming up with the ideas and looking at the prototypes that we can then go ahead. These are the people who said, we want to dedicate our time and our resources. None of them was paid for this. They gave their time, their resources, and really worked. These were the people in the social lab. And I'm sure some of you would recognize yourselves here or other people that you know. Thank you very much for the support that you have given Ringo. We've not finished, we've not closed, we've not ended, but it is important to say thank you and acknowledge what it is that you have done, the contribution you have made. And we want to move on to the next group. This is our Ringo Rios team, past and present. There were some of us who joined in the beginning for one reason or the other, had to leave the process, but still stayed connected in one way or the other. So I want to say thank you to all of you for your dedication, for your sacrifice. I know how much many of you have sacrificed to get us this far. Thank you so much for that. Thank you very much to the Ringo and Rios team. Thank you. The work continues, aluta continua, but it is important to recognize your contribution. So thank you very much. And I also want to say, is this the last slide that we have? Yeah. So before we celebrate, let me also thank our interpreters who have been with us all through and have helped us to communicate fluently and to understand each other. Communication is very, very important, as we've talked about a lot this week, and to have them support us get that done well is something that we need to appreciate. So thank you. Thank you very much. Merci beaucoup. Muchos gracias. And last but not the least, and I know she will be surprised because I did not tell her, I want us to thank Deborah Dole, who initiated Ringo and convened us and sacrificed so much to get us going. There are many people who think of fantastic ideas, but they never implement them. But Deborah, you decided to take the bull by the horns, and you have brought all of us this far. So thank you. And may we have many more of you in our space to spare us on. Thank you, Deborah. Thank you very much. I know that you didn't expect this, but I just had to do it and acknowledge what it is that you have done. Thank you very much. So now we close with the poem we began with, Reimagining Yesteryear, which was written by Jevin Chanase and will be performed by Jim Chick Fomunjong. Jim, over to you now.
Thank you very much, Nana, and everyone present. Reimagining yesterday, today, and tomorrow. You never know how strong you are until you face pressure you have never faced. Wise words from a man with silver hair, describing to me the tales of this movement. Dazed and yet unfazed by their surroundings and the innuendos cast by their detractors. This, a storied tale of South-South kinsmen, diasporan women, and brothers and sisters united by ideas and the dignity of the Homo sapien. Theirs is the quest to redefine the logic of organic development, rewriting and annotating the rules of engagement, no longer ascribing to the white wisdom of Northern foster fathers, rediscovering the ancient philosophies and truths buried in sacred hills and oracles, rechanneling the birthing pain of the ghetto of yesteryears into ambition, baptizing every beast, man and woman, into apostles of progress and innovation. this movement has found the hidden gems to illuminate our path to progress. They have discovered the antidote to cure our frailties as a collective. Now in our bruised hands, we hold the balm for century-old wounds of inaction and indecision. Now in our hearts and minds, the unspoken agenda lays siege to our consternation. From this moment, on every village rooftop, the war drums of this peaceful message will delight every progressive ear, but disrupt the demons of every obstructive soul. And verily, our work is cut out. Much remains undone. Yet again, we must dissolve the artificial borders and mental gates that telepathically keep us apart. Sow the seed of this righteous rebellion into the psyche of this evanescent generation. Weave the banner of self-belief as a firmament that engulfs the broken skies of a society. And finally, discard our own indignations to birth the imaginations and inclinations of the community. How shall we define ourselves then? No. How do we want to be remembered by the community? A movement? A network? A nation? No. We are the reawakened consciousness, the reimagined nation of you, me, and they, the ones upon whose shoulders the globe rests. It's a great responsibility. The die is cast. Say less. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Jim. The die is cast. And I want to remember Theosoa's feminist quote earlier. She said, "What is the point of a revolution if you can't dance? What is life without some fun?" So for everyone who can, please join us as we let down our hair. If you have any, there may be some who don't have. But whatever you let down, let's just enjoy and celebrate each other. Join us for the Ringo's Got Talent session, which I think is coming up now, and have a good time. So you can stay. Is it this link or it's another link, I guess. Okay, there's another link. Is there another link?
No, can we use this one?
Yeah, there's another link, I think.
Oh, no, same link.
Same link.
Stay here.
It's the same link. So we are staying. You can stay and just join us for Ringo's Got Talent and let's have a good time. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Nana.
Thank you very much.
Now, who's the talent?